We have seen some wild upsets this election season. I think that the one that really stands out to me is Marquita Bradshaw in Tennessee. That was nuts. Like, she
literally no one saw that coming. I don't think she was endorsed by, like, I mean, maybe a few groups, DSA maybe, but literally no one. No, I don't even know she was on
no one's radar. Yeah. I don't know anyone who had heard of her. Nobody. She raised $8,000 for a Senate race in Tennessee, which is much bigger. Yeah, against $2 million, outraised 250-1. Yeah. And it breaks my brain every time. It's like, you know what? If she could do that with $8,000 in the middle of a pandemic, like, I don't know.
Well, it just shows how desperate the American people are for something different. She was able to ride the momentum of people saying, fuck it, we're pissed. We're ready for change. You know, I mean, the momentum that was created by, we'll call them the George Floyd protests, but they encompass the, you know, tragic deaths of many others that I don't, you know, want to be excluded from the memory. I think that people at that moment, you know, obviously there was the disheartening race in Kentucky and what happened at the peak of all of that with
Charles Booker and
the Amy Booker McGrath. Race.
Yeah.
But I think that the Marquita Bradshaw, people in her community saw somebody that they trusted, that they thought would, you know, really fulfill on this, you know, very critical issue. And I think that, you know, it shows that when you're, you know, saying the right things and speaking to people about something that they're, you know, desperate for, that they will come out for you. And I think that was a real lesson that we should all learn from.
Yeah, I actually recently spoke to Marquita on the show, and she mentioned that, you know, she's a climate activist, right? And, you know, the Green New Deal is usually not considered a policy that's particularly popular with the more Appalachian, you know, people that have had communities that have had jobs in the coal or gas industries. And obviously Kentucky fits that bill to some extent. And Marquita told me
essentially Tennessee,
but Kentucky as well, you know?
Yeah.
She told me that she put it in terms, these policies that the working people would understand. You know, she said that, you know, a lot of people that aren't necessarily Democrats, that aren't necessarily leftists, that don't even necessarily believe in climate change, they do recognize pollution as an issue. You know, they see it in their communities. Marquita grew up down the street from like a military waste facility, and essentially, which was leaking toxic material into her community, which was killing the dogs and cats and animals, like insane stuff. So, you know, people experience this stuff, especially disenfranchised, lower income, black and brown communities in this country. They experience the effects of pollution, of climate change, of all of these things, but they just might not necessarily realize, you know, the right policies, the right candidates that are going to, you know, further their own happiness, their own lives, and get these things removed from their, you know, life. Marquita Bradshaw was able to put it in those terms that the voters understood, and she was able to connect with those voters. She also pushed back when I, you know, called Tennessee a red state and said, no, it's actually not a red state, because look how many people in the state don't vote, have been disenfranchised and can't, you know, really have their voice heard. This is a state that is so voter suppressed that, you know, the actual working people, the working class communities, which have been so disenfranchised, their voice isn't even being heard. And she was able to tap into that. Hopefully she's able to in the general as well.
Yeah, I saw her message out or email out something, I think, because I donate to her campaign. I think she, you know, I'm on her mailing list, and I saw her send out an email recently that mentioned the voter turnout rate in the election was something like 27% or something like that. And so it's like, I forget if she was talking about last time in a general or if it was in the primary race that she had won, but that is, you know, abysmally low voter turnout. And so that means that there's a large segment of the population that could potentially be reached if you are speaking to issues that, you know, these standard establishment politicians haven't been speaking to for the last, you know, decades, where we've just seen a stagnation of wages and the, you know, the destruction of our planet. And so I think that somebody like Marquita standing up and, you know, being a climate activist and having that background and focusing on those issues, I think it says a lot to the fact that people are paying closer attention more than ever now and are actually, you know, oftentimes I think there's definitely an age gap with this, but I think that the younger generation certainly is very intensely policy focused. And if you're speaking to those issues, then they are not only willing to vote for you, but they are excited, enough to go out there and to volunteer, to make phone calls, to text, to knock on doors, even when it's possible. And so I think that a race like that shows us that there's hope. There's certainly hope.
Thanks for watching Radical Democracy Podcast. I'm your host, Kamali Rose. Please like and share this video, subscribe to the channel, and if it doesn't bother you, hit that bell below to receive notifications whenever we go live or launch a new video. Please leave your thoughts in the comments below, and if you can afford it, do me a huge favor and head over to my Patreon at patreon.com/radicaldemocracy. And throw me a few bucks, whatever you can afford. It goes a long way and I will greatly appreciate it. It helps the channel to continue to exist and to grow. And I really appreciate the support. Thank you so much and I hope to see you soon. All right, peace. All right, that was a good one. That one's it.